The rise of online dating across the globe is no secret. But what is a secret is the algorithm different apps like Hinge, Tinder, or Bumble use to find you your perfect match. With Valentine's Day coming up, you might be wondering, how can I use math to find myself a Valentine's Day date? Or maybe you're just really interested in understanding how dating algorithms work. Either way, this video has what you're looking for, as we'll be diving deep into things like cosine ranking, ELO rankings, collaborative filtering, and the Gale Shapley algorithm, which all play a crucial role in the world of online matchmaking. Now, as I mentioned at the beginning, dating apps keep their cards close to their chest when it comes to revealing their exact algorithms. So everything here is more or less speculative based on the information that we could find. But I think you'll still find this insight worthwhile to better understand how to improve your own success on these apps. In our last video in this linear algebra series, we covered the dot product and introduced you to how it helps create measures of similarity. You can catch up on that video clicking here. But one commonly used measure of similarity we discussed was cosine ranking. Now, from what I've gathered, most apps use either cosine ranking or ELO ranking to initially group users. Tinder and Bumble have used ELO ranking in the past, and most likely currently use some form of it still. While Hinge uses cosine ranking and the Gale Shapley algorithm, which we'll cover at the very end of the video. So, what's the difference? ELO ranking pits users or players against each other to numerically rank them. It's used in a lot more than just dating apps. Most popularly, it ranks players in chess. Each chess player is given an initial score, usually based off of past season performances. Then, as each player goes against another, their score either increases or decreases, depending on if they won or lost, and how highly ranked their opponent was. These dating apps take a similar approach with your likes or swipes. The more people swipe on you, the higher your score is, and you in turn get fed other users with similar ELO scores for you to swipe on and potentially match with. But cosine ranking is different. It doesn't look at pitting users against each other, but rather looks for similarity between users. Cosine ranking measures similarity between two vectors by how near or far apart the angle is between the vectors. So think of all those questions you answered when you created your dating profile. They ask you about your hobbies, job, religion, sexual orientation, political affiliation, favorite food, books, movies, etc. Each user is a vector that contains all of that data. Then, using cosine ranking, it can determine how similar you are to any other user in the system using this formula. So how was this formula derived? Well, here's the proof. Suppose we have two vectors, U and V. We'd like to know how similar they are by how small or large the angle between them is. If we dropped a perpendicular line from one vector to the other, we'd have this handy right triangle. And we know there's a lot of trigonometry out there that can help us find the measure of this angle. Maybe you're already screaming cosine at the screen. Yes, cosine of theta is adjacent over hypotenuse, which are the two sides our vectors lie on. The only problem is vector u may be longer or shorter than our adjacent side. So first we need to find what scalar k will scale vector u up or down to this new length we'll call r. And let's call our perpendicular vector w. Now, what did we learn last video about perpendicular vectors? Oh yes, their dot product will always equal zero. So r dotted with w equals zero. But we're trying to express r as a scaled version of u, so k times u dotted with w equals zero. And as we mentioned in the last video, we can distinguish between scalars like k and vectors like u with this notation. So we can also think of w as the difference between vector v and r. And r is k times w. We learned this fact about the sum and difference of vectors in part one of this series. You can go back and watch it using the link here. So with all these substitutions, we have a really nice equation that we can solve for k and get this. K is u dot v divided by u dot u. Lastly, with our scalar k for vector u, we can plug everything into our cosine formula and simplify. Since this value here is just a constant, we can pull it out, leaving us with this expression. If we recall what we learned last video about the length of a vector being the square root of the dot product with itself, we can then simplify this part of the expression, and we're left with our final formula. Now we actually have a way to find the angle between vectors by using this formula and solving for theta. But if we only care about finding good matches, we don't need the angle. We can use the cosine of the angle. It cuts down on computation and gets us a really nice scale for comparison. 1 is a perfect match, 0 is perpendicular, and -1 is the worst match because it represents two vectors going in opposite directions. Actually, if we rewrite the formula this way, then we can see something else. A vector divided by its length is a scaled vector of the original but has length 1. So if we scale our vectors to length 1 first, then the dot product is the cosine of the angle between them. This insight is what powers dating app matchmaking systems. They aren't computing angles directly, just using the dot product of normalized vectors to efficiently rank potential matches. Now you might be wondering, but most people don't want to be with someone who is 100% or even 90% similar to them, right? It's usually best to have some things in common and other things opposite. That's where dating apps start to behave more like Netflix or Amazon recommendations. When dating moved from online websites to phone apps, a new matching system emerged: collaborative filtering. Rather than matching you with someone similar to potentially date, they instead match you with a similar user and use their behavior to feed you new candidates. This is a lot easier to explain in terms of movies. Say we have 4 Netflix addicts. Each of them has watched the same set of 10 movies, plus each has watched 3 additional movies that none of the others have seen. We can use their ratings on the 10 shared movies to determine which viewers have the most similar taste. Then, once we find a strong match, we can recommend the unique movies that only that match has seen. Let's find a good recommendation for viewer A using this method. First, we calculate the cosine similarity between viewer A's ratings on the shared movies and each of the other 3 viewers. From this, we see that viewer C is the best match. So now, to give a recommendation, we look at viewer C's highest rated movies that A hasn't seen yet, Casablanca, and recommend it to viewer A. Collaborative filtering has proved to be so effective that in 2006, Netflix offered $1 million to any method that could improve their recommendations by 10% over their then current recommendation algorithm. It took 3 years, but in 2009, Bellcore's Pragmatic Chaos was announced the winner. The advantage of collaborative filtering is that it leverages the collective behavior of similar users to provide more personalized and potentially novel recommendations to the users. Dating apps can do this too. They could feed you potential matches that are similar to you, yes. Or they could use collaborative filtering to match you to a similar user and then feed you the same or similar profiles that this other user has indicated interest in. The idea is that if 2 people share similar preferences and profiles, they might also share similar tastes in potential partners. Finally, there is a third mechanism employed by dating apps to find you a potential partner: the Gale Shapley algorithm. Hinge has openly stated that they use the Gale Shapley algorithm as part of their matching system. Exactly how it's used is a bit more of a mystery, but here's my take. First, some history. The Gale Shapley algorithm is widely used in different fields, most famously in residency matching for medical students. It works by taking 2 groups, such as applicants and hospitals, and systematically creates stable matches based on preferences. Each applicant and hospital submits their list of preferences, and then the algorithm systematically checks each pairing until everyone is paired with their most preferred hospital that also prefers them back. But in dating apps, I think this often works differently. Users do not explicitly rank their potential matches. Instead, the app observes the user's history of likes and dislikes, previous interactions with users, and their stated dating preferences to curate your preferred list for you. It then systematically checks these potential pairings with other users' curated prefer lists to then create your most compatible section. This is a list of people that you both prefer and who are most likely to prefer you back, according to the algorithm. So this is where the Gale Shapley algorithm differs from ELO ranking, cosine ranking, or collaborative filtering. It's not just feeding you people you would prefer, but actively filters them by who is also most likely to prefer you as well. So how can this info help improve your chances in the online dating world? I have some thoughts, but what do you think? Comment below. Knowing now how these algorithms work, what strategies could you take to improve your ability to get more matches?
Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.